Dynamic.
Yeah,
because I haven't met him yet. I reached out to him.
You've been anointed.
Thank you.
I don't know about you, but I'm involved in other things also in the community.
Me too. Yeah, I'm a coach. I coach my son's teams.
I chair the facility master plan that we're doing. So. Plus, being the superintendent of buildings, I go to meetings constantly.
Got that whole school system going over there, brand new school and everything. Yeah. That's incredible.
So you're a busy guy.
That's incredible.
Yeah, I'm pretty busy. You know, so it.
What's the school thing you have going on?
Oh, we just completed a new high school over at the.
In Reading, North Reading. Wilmington. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
I knew North Reading just completed theirs.
$84 million building. So.
Wow, we got new schools everywhere. North Reading just opened theirs.
$84 million. That's staggering.
Yeah, imagine. Yeah, we were fortunate though. We went through the MSBA with the state.
Yeah.
It does
so they
give you
pay
some
one-third
constraints in the building, but they paid 49%.
Wow,
that's great
for
Wilmington. That's fantastic. Yeah. Did Reading, North Reading get as good a deal? Because they did it too.
They used the same designers that we had.
Yeah, but I don't think they got 49% paid by the state.
I'm not sure what they got as far, but they combined also their middle and high school.
Oh, that's true. So they get some economies of scale.
And the only thing, you know, and it's great that you get that funding, but they look at it a little differently than you and I would look at it, because we're like, we want a bigger gymnasium. We're like, well, no, you only have this many kids, so this number of kids fits this.
Is that right? Yeah. Really?
Huh. And they'll offer you a model school, you know, where every community is different. Like one of our programs, we have a strings attached.
Yeah.
And it's a, you know, they all play the violin. There's 140 kids in there, you know, so...
Yeah,
we had to design our music room a little differently, and it's probably three times the size that they wanted us to. So,
but to accommodate everybody,
So we did a lot of auditorium spectacular. If you ever have a chance, you want to come into Wilmington and look at it.
I'd love to see it.
Come in as my guest. We'll walk you through it. We bring people into the sound booth for the auditorium.
Wow,
people that come in, it's like this is all high end professional stuff. Which is great for the kids.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. It really is.
You know? And we went from an antiquated high school to this
super modern.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But
great.
It's hard to get the community to buy into that because inevitably
it's got to last for a long time, too. So.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what you have to sell it as. Too.
Yeah.
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 And then, of course, the housing, you know, everybody is buying in now, and Wilmington's like.
Yep.
Oh, the boom. Is the housing boom going on in Wilmington right now?
Unbelievable.
Really?
My parents live in a decent neighborhood, and I grew up there. The house next door went on the market. 1 hour later, the guy got his asking price, and he accepted it. And I was talking to him. I said, so your house went on the market? He goes, yeah, it's sold. And he goes, I come through. I said, why didn't you hold out a little? He goes, I got my asking price.
Yeah, right. You hold out, and then the deal falls apart. And
I've heard, George, that many realtors are listening at a slightly lower price, and things get bid up by 10 or 15% over asking.
David,
how are you? David, how are you?
Good evening.
Good. How you doing?
Good.
Yeah.
All right. Good to go. Okay. Call this meeting to order.
Yes, sir.
Startle.
This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Board of Commissioners being videotaped at the RMLD offices at 230 Ash Street. Tonight we're being videotaped. People can see us on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 23. Our videographer tonight is Ernie. Welcome, Ernie. We are not alive tonight, even though I think we're all feeling pretty good.
We're not live.
We're not live tonight.
Oh.
Being taped.
Okay. And let me read the our code of conduct. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda as well as on items not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions and comments from the public be directed to the chair and that all parties, including members of the RMLD Board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It is the role of the chair to maintain order on all public comment or ensuing discussion. Very good. And tonight I am our chair is absent.
Mm-hmm.
So I am the temporary, non-permanent acting chair that he reminded me of. and not to get too comfortable, he
it's
told
a,
me.
It's a good, good position.
All right. Our secretary tonight is Mr. Stenbeck.
Thank you.
Okay. And so we kind of got the introductions. George, George Hooper is our representative from the CAB. And I believe we also have a representative from the Finance Committee with us tonight, too. So we welcome everybody. And we'll have public comment. Anybody got anything they want to bring up at this point? If not, I don't see anybody, so we'll go to the report of the committees. And there were no meetings, so, and basically, I don't think there was a CAB meeting either. So there's nothing to report on that meeting. And I believe your next meeting is March the 1st, so we'll need somebody to actually attend that meeting. We'll be March the 1st, the next meeting of the CAB.
Okay.
We'll get to that later on. So our first item is we're now at item 7, to accept the changes to section 30 of the chapter 32B as amended by the recent legislation. Do we have a setup? Colleen, are you going to give us a setup on this as to what this is, or why we need to do this, if you would, please?
State law change?
There was additional language was added. It's pretty much what was went over when we had the audit report when they mentioned the OPEB liability. So the law now states a municipal lighting plan that establishes an OPEB fund shall pay the premiums and assume the liability for the municipal share of retiree health care benefits attributable to lighting plan employees and their dependents.
Okay.
So the town manager just asked that we accept the change.
Okay.
So that's the reason why it's on there.
Yep.
Sounds fine. Why do we need to vote to accept a change in state law?
I thought it was a little serious, too, but for some reason
what if we
leave it on the record that we realized that there was a change.
Probably because the financials will change because of it. The same thing that the auditors had stated.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess I haven't seen it though. That's the only thing. Is there a need to approve it immediately at this meeting? I mean, I don't mind, but I just haven't seen the actual document.
It's done before the April town meeting, so if you want, I can send everyone a copy of the legislation.
I was thinking maybe we should table it until we
have
a look at it.
Whatever you all want to do.
I guess I just wonder what is the thing that we're doing with this item on the agenda?
Yeah. They asked that we put it on the town.
Okay. I mean, if it has implications for our operations that we need to execute on, okay. But if I don't understand it otherwise.
Yeah. So let's do this. Let's not take action on it tonight.
Good idea.
And then between now and the next meeting, let's maybe circulate information as to why this is being done, why this is necessary for us to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe get copies of everybody. Actually, maybe this, look, you've got something else there that he's got there.
That.
Maybe we should get the copies of that out to all the members of the commission.
And if we need to do it sooner, we can always do a special.
Okay, well, I mean, we do it before April 1st, so.
Right.
That'll be fine. Okay, so that brings us to Colleen. You're up with your report.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. First, I wanted to say that it was a pleasure to meet two new CAB members. Not CBA, that's collective bargaining agreement.
Freudian slip.
You've been today. You can tell where you've been today.
Did I give that away? Don't even make me blush. Two new CAB members. One, Neil Cohen from Reading, will bring to the table his experience and expertise in as an attorney. And Jason Small from Reading, will bring to the table as an electrical engineer in distribution engineering. So great addition to the board. And so spent a few hours with them both last week. Went through, gave them a pretty good overview of how things work, operations. And I think they're they're both going to be a great asset to the team. So just wanted to share that with you. This weekend starts the APPA 2007 Legislative Rally. And so I'll be going down there Sunday afternoon and come back Wednesday. I'm really excited about it. I've never been before. I know it's, you could think I would have been, but you've all gotten some correspondence from me. You know, since deregulation, generally we have a lot of people who represent us and lobbyists and different things that help support the benefits of public power. And, you know, we're being faced with a lot of changes with the new administration. And so it'll be very exciting to go down there and talk about impacts to public power and what we can do to keep our rates as low as they are. So I'll report when I get back and give you all a summary of the events and what we were able to accomplish. Next is the art contest award ceremony. We had a great time. I know a lot of you were there on different nights, but I hope everyone was happy with the transition. I know change is difficult, but we went from a t-shirt contest to an art contest. And if you haven't had a chance, we've put more artwork up, and we're going to be putting some artwork in the lobby. The challenge in the lobby is to make sure that the sun does not destroy any of the children's artwork, so we'll probably just put it up between now and May. It was on the 15th and the 16th. We did Linfield and North Reading on the 15th, and then Wilmington and Reading on the 16th. And we had 12 schools, three winners from each school, so we were able to give out 36 prizes and awards to help the education for the and supplies for the art department. So I think everybody had a good time. It was a much quicker presentation and award show than the t-shirts. I would say it was about an hour presentation, so I think that was very good for families and for children. They loved seeing their artwork up, so I think it was a great success. I hope you guys enjoyed it as well, and if you have any feedback on it, what you'd like to see next year, improvements or anything, just let me know or let Jane know, and we can make that happen.
Yeah, I thought it went very well. I attended both nights. I thought it went very well both nights on that. I thought the kids were particularly articulate when they described what they had done. I mean, just amazing. Mm. To be that articulate and that young, you know?
Yeah.
Absolutely amazing.
And I liked the fact that Jane's group presented it on a very large screen, computer screen. And so, you know, it just was really good. And everyone got to see the detail of the artwork. So, and as Phil said, they did articulate. It was
yeah.
Very cute.
Mm-hmm.
The RMLD Lunch and Learn, Jane's group is holding on March 22nd a Lunch and Learn workshop for peak demand reduction customers. It's we have about 20 customers, commercial customers, signed up for that, so they'll be coming in to learn more about that program. The presentations to the Board of Selectmen continue because of some meetings and things on their end. Some of them have gotten pushed back, but the Reading Selectmen will take place on March 7th. And those usually go really well, and then all I have left after that is North Reading. They've had some issues that have, you know, tied up their meetings for a little bit now, and so hopefully I'll be able to get over there at the end of March. So that's all I have to report on. Unless there's any questions?
One question, Colleen. Yeah. On the 20 commercial customers that are coming in to discuss the peak shaving, were they some of the biggest power users?
I'll defer that to Jane.
Oh, okay. Oh, she's going to talk about that already?
Jane's up.
Oh, there we go.
Anyway.
Good segue.
Why don't you come right up? Good segue.
That worked out good.
Come on right up.
I didn't plan that. That was just...
Well,
sometimes
it, question, Dave.
Sometimes it works out.
I have a question while Jane's getting set up, if I may. So this APPEA...
Yeah.
What is it? It's a lobbying sort of blitz down in Washington?
Well, it's a conference, but what NEPA is doing is we're actually meeting with all of the legislators as opposed to going to the conference meetings. We actually have specific meetings set up with different legislators.
Is there a legislative agenda that we're getting behind? Like specific laws or regulations that we're pushing for or against?
There are some issues on ICAP, and there's some issues on clean energy standards, which I shared with you.
That was a state one, though.
It is a state one, but there are going to be, there is an issue between the state's direction on, you know, clean energy for the entire country and what the federals are going to be talking about. So I think there'll be some commonality with some of the topics.
Could you possibly let us know what the issues are?
Yeah, actually, Gene got the agenda today,
yep.
The specifics, because they're making assignments of who's going to be going which direction. Not everyone's going to each meeting, so they're breaking us up and assigning it. So I'll be glad to pass that along with
I would appreciate
what the speaker is going to talk about.
The reason I say is, you know, we're at a moment now where we have Washington rolling back regulations on coal and making our energy supply nationwide potentially dirtier. I just want to make sure that we as an organization are thinking about what it is we're pushing for, and maybe we're pushing against what some of these things are. I just would like to know what the details are.
That's where I was thinking that the clean energy for the state is going to be tying into what the federal is not going to be doing. And so it is a discussion.
Okay. But it would be good just to know what the issues are that we're getting behind or opposing. That's all.
There may be some issues that come up specifically in a meeting that, you know, a manager may bring up that's not specifically on the agenda as
sure.
well. So I'll give you a copy of
to the extent.
Topics.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, if NEPA's going down with a certain agenda or APPA has a certain agenda that we're implicitly getting behind or opposing, that's all. I'm just wondering what that is. Yeah. Thanks.
If I can just add to Colleen's point on one of the things that we're dealing with on the ISO front that kind of dovetails with the clean energy standard is IMAP, which is integrating markets and public policy. So the states, the New England states, have statewide RFPs for renewable energy, and they're trying to figure out a way to take those mandates and incorporate those into the markets. One of the concerns that the states have is once they become part of the ISO markets, then they lose local control, and that goes to FERC jurisdiction. So that becomes a national as opposed to a state.
Okay.
So we've been meeting continuously since August of last year up through February on the ISO front, and we're kind of in a little hiatus until the states can determine where they want to position themselves. Do they want to incorporate that and relinquish the authority to FERC, or do they want to maintain that? And so that's where that may come into play during Colleen's discussions with on the federal level.
Okay. All right, Jane.
And to add, if I could answer Dave's question about the peak demand reduction program. Currently, we have 20 customers that sign, and there are of various usage groups. They're mostly the higher usage, but they range from the high school in North Reading to the large Textron companies.
Oh,
and so what we're doing is we're taking some lessons learned, some customers who have achieved success in reducing their peak and obtaining some financial results, to share that with other customers, so that it's one of those things, once you do it and you receive the benefit, it becomes part of your routine.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're hoping to instill some of those lessons learned.
Thank you.
Very good. Proceed
okay,
forward.
And now I'm here to report on purchase power for the month of December. We have about six graphs to discuss today. And what we did is, because it's December, we looked on a calendar year basis from January to December, even though the department operates on a fiscal year budget. So the first graph depicts heating and cooling degrees. And as we've talked to before, this is a measurement to determine the demand of energy needed for either heating or cooling, which is correlating to electricity use. This is arrived at by taking the average of the high and low temperature of the day and subtracting that from 65, so you get a basis point to determine if it was a cooler or warmer degree depending on the season. So if you look at the graph here, the first 3 months of the winter period, you can see that the winter was slightly milder, or considerably lot milder, in 2016 than it was in 2015. And those are depicted by the first three bar charts. If you shoot back to the end of the month in November and December, it was slightly, November was pretty much flat, but December was much colder in 2016 than it was in 2015. If we kind of look at the summer months, June, July, and August, because those really direct our electricity sales, you can see that 2016 was slightly warmer or hotter, which there was an increase in cooling degree days in both June, July, and August. And that all correlates to electricity consumption, which I'll show in the next graph. But I wanted to give you a basis of why some things are happening. So if we look at the next graph, this depicts our purchase power costs, which include all of our capacity, transmission, and energy charges, and versus the system peak. So for calendar year 2016, on a overall basis, purchase power expenses were around $64.2 million in 2016. That compares to a slight decrease from 2015, which was $64.5 million. So we were down by about $332,000 overall on total purchase power costs. Some of that was weather related, a lot of that was energy related. Obviously, capacity and transmission continue to increase, so it's the energy that really sways those components. If you look at the line graph, which we were looking at our monthly peak demands, 2015 was typically lower than 2016 for the majority of the period, the calendar year, with the exception of the peak day in August. And I think that was a lot related to the cooling degree days. We hit a slightly higher peak in August than we did in 2016 than we did in 2015. And actually 2015, we peaked in July rather than August. So again, our peaks tends to be pretty stable. There's not huge swings about that. And we're hoping that with our new communication manager, who's with us today, this is Joey Mulvaney. We're going to emphasize more of an educational program and educate our customers, both commercial, residential, on the value of that reduction. If we go to the next slide, the last slide included a lot of material, and so what I asked the analysts to do is look at the purchase power costs by components for the years 2015 and 2016. So this first graph looks at the calendar year 2015, and if we look at the components of capacity, transmission, and energy, for 2015, capacity costs for the calendar year totaled about $18.1 million. Transmission was $12.1 million, and energy was around $34 million. And this kind of just shows you the different components by month. The next graph looks at those same components for 2016, and capacity increased from 18.1 to 19.7. So there was about a $1.7 million increase in that. Transmission went from 12.1 to 12.7, so another $600,000 increase in transmission costs year to year. And fuel actually went down from $34 million to $32 million. And so that's where we see, with the increases in capacity and transmission, we're offset by some of our fuel decreases. And so those were the two purchase power. And I had a lot of slides for you guys this month as opposed to my normal three. Mm-hmm. The next slide looks at kilowatt hour sales. In 2016, we had a total of approximately 670 million kilowatt hours sold. In 2015, we had about 691.5. So that was about a 3% decrease from 2015 to 2016 in kilowatt hour sales. And again, if you look at the graph, the bar graph, the line graph indicates the sales. And there's an increase in August and September, as well as, the sales are the bar graphs. And an interesting fact is we peak in September because there's a lag in our billing cycle. So our September bills actually reflect our August usage.
Right.
And where August was such a hot month, it was our peak month. That's why the bar graph is highest during the month of September. And there was a couple, I believe Commissioner O'Rourke had requested some information from me at the last meeting in regards to the number of customers that are on auto pay, paperless, et cetera. So the last slide includes some of the information. The RMLD has accumulated over 18,000 customer emails, which has been beneficial in terms of a way to communicate efficiently with the customers. After our last campaign in this past summer, we've increased our paperless billing to over 7,000 customers. That saves on paper, saves on the expense of having to print a bill, stamp it, mail it, et cetera. Additionally, on auto pay, which is a great thing for both the customer as well as the light department, we have over 7,000 customers. Customers who sign up on auto pay have their payment taken out on the very last discount date, so it doesn't get taken out. They're guaranteed the discount, which is a 15% reduction on their electricity bill on the base portion of that. So we're going to be working on some campaigns to continue that increase, because it helps for credit collection, it helps for people to maintain their bills, it's very efficient.
Jane, I imagine those two 7,000s, the paperless billing and the auto pay, that's probably the same people in most cases?
Not necessarily. You don't have to sign up for both.
Yeah.
Both. You can sign up for, most people do, but we do have customers who may want one or the other. But they usually go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Usually it's that generation that they don't want, you know, they'll look online, they don't need a hard copy, and they just prefer to automatically set up everything. And meeting with just a little side note on that, one of the interesting facts that we need to communicate to our customers is when people pay their bills and they're using their online banking service, there's a significant delay as to when the RMLD receives that payment. So if you're on your computer using your online banking and you make a payment on the day before the discount or the discount day, it can take anywhere from 2 to 5 days for the RML to receive that payment. However, if you go on RMLD's website and pay through the website using your checking or credit card, we get that payment that night. So you're guaranteed that payment. And customers aren't aware of the delays associated with paying their bill using their online banking. And that's just the software, the CheckFree, that has to go through. And because RMLD is such a small vendor, we can't speed that up for any reason. So again, we're gonna work on educating our customers on that factor and encourage them to go on the website so that they achieve the discount. And even if they sign up on auto pay, it's that much better. We also have, as part of one of our invoice cloud payment options, we have a pay by text. That's a new feature that we're starting to explore. We have over 800 customers with 481 registered, where you'll get a text message, and then you can just press 1 or 2 to pay your bill. Hmm. It's a very convenient feature, and again, it's very popular with the younger generation. Our mobile app, we've had 494 downloads since its inception. And we have over 800 followers on Twitter, and that increased almost over 200 followers with the last storms that we had, the nor'easter on Thursday and followed by the Monday storm. Our station is doing an excellent job reporting that the outage, where the outage is, the estimated time for restoration, and people are finding it very convenient to know how long it's going to take when their power is going back. So again, we encourage people to sign up on our Twitter feed, and we'll be doing more campaigns to increase that number. And with the, we don't currently have a Facebook, but now that we have Tracy on board, we're gonna be, Joyce, Tracy's over there. We're gonna be exploring that option as another way to increase our social media presence.
Great.
And that concludes my report.
Okay. Questions, comments?
No, thank you. Excellent.
Very good.
Thank
excellent.
You.
Very terrific.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can we go back to the OPEB just because I've read through it?
Okay.
Just for a second.
Yeah, if you would, please.
Mm-hmm. So the Section 20 of Chapter 32B is the other post-employment benefit liability trust fund has already been established. You guys have already voted on that previously. I'm not sure, Wendy, if you know what year that happened. So that's already occurred. You already voted on that. So what this particular item is, one section, and the reason why the municipal plant would be, the commissioners would vote on it, is because we have our own OPEB trust fund. So we're not, it's not part of the town, we have our own.
Mm-hmm.
So if you've already established your own, which we have, it says that the Board of Commissioners will vote to accept this language. And the language says, a municipal lighting plant that's established an OPEB fund shall pay the premiums and assume the liability for the municipal share of the retiree health care benefits attributable to lighting plant employees and their dependents. So it appears to be just one sentence that basically says, it's your trust, you're responsible for it. So perhaps, you know, it's adding language in there to just make sure that you're not going to assume that the town is going to be paying their share. It's your trust, it's your share. So that's what the language is for. I wasn't here for the original trust vote, so.
Okay. Are you asking us to vote for that motion under number 7? Because then we could.
I am. If okay. If you're
so
content
inclined.
With what I've just established, that's.
Yeah, I remember we set it up.
Yeah,
we established
it. Right. We established it. Right.
So it's really just definitional in terms of.
It's reiterating the autonomy of your of the responsibility of the RMLD to pay its premiums, and that we're responsible for the retirees and their dependents, which. Wendy, correct me if I'm wrong, it probably got added because maybe that it had got questioned by another town or another entity, so it's got put in there so that it's clear.
Yeah, I have no issue with that.
Okay, well, do you want to make a motion then?
Sure. how should I phrase this?
The motion is right here.
I apologize.
Motion in the
That's okay. Let me just state it then. move that the Board of Commissioners accept the provisions of Section 20 of Chapter 32B of the Massachusetts General Laws as amended by Section 15 of the Chapter 218 of the Acts of 2016, establishing and other post-employment benefits liability trust fund.
Yep. And the only thing I would add at the end of that is on the recommendation of the general manager.
On the recommendation of the general manager.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Have a second?
Second.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. Discussion? See then. All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? Let the record show that motion carried 4-0. All right. Very good. Wendy, you're up now.
Good evening.
Hello, Wendy.
Hello, Wendy.
So we're a little better prepared today. We're getting there. I'm excited. We had Great Plains consultant in the office this week for 3 days, helping us build our financial reports as promised. And I am extremely excited about the possibilities of what we can get out of our system and have our software work for us versus what we've been doing. So
that's great.
It's still going to take time, of course. Everything takes time, but it looks like it may not take as much time as I was thinking it would. So I'm even more excited. So until we get that up and running fully, the reports, as I said last time, we're still tweaking them, and they're not perfect as far as format and what exactly I want to present. So I'm just going with what I have prepared for you month by month. Okay?
Okay.
So in my department, we have a new staff accountant. Once again, excited, more help, get us in line. And I forgot to mention last month that we participated in the Standard & Poor's Global study, which gives us a rating. So we have an A+, we've been given an A+ rating, which says that we have a stable outlook, which is really good in case we need to go for bonds or anything like that, any other companies looking at us, and that's our rating, and it's public information. Okay?
Great.
So looking at the balance sheet, you'll notice the receivables are up because it's moratorium right now, and it's pretty typical that right now we're only at 78% receivables, but then it, you know, it starts to get back to normal, the 90-95% as the months go on and the moratorium ends in April. So that's where we stand with that. Right now, we're 7 million in payables, and we pay our payables at about 30 to 45 days. So that's revolving constantly, and looks like we have a lot of projects going on. But it's right on line with last year. Mm-hmm. And then if within our liabilities, there's about a $1.2 million town payment that there's a timing issue there, so it didn't get posted this month. So you may see that in January. So that would be coming out of the cash. And then if you turn to the second page.
If I may, Wendy,
yep,
just
sorry.
A quick question.
Yep.
The accrued liabilities under current from $3 million to $10 million, is that
yep,
the
that's the $8.8 million, the net pension. And with my new reports, I've already put that as a separate line item.
Right. Okay.
Okay?
Thank you.
Visibility is always key, in my opinion. Page two, if we look at the schedule of capital assets, you can see exactly where our capital projects are focusing on our structures and improvements. You can see the increase there, about $1.6 million or so, and our infrastructure's up another $1 million. So that's where all of our capital projects are mm-hmm. focusing on, our maintenance of the infrastructure, as Colleen and Hamid always stress that's necessary. Page three takes a look at our revenues, and compared to last year, we're a little bit higher, not too much higher, but it looks like we're over collecting a little bit on the fuel and PPCT. It's not significant, and overall, it's only a 5% increase right now. But again, that's revolving. That's the timing of our accounts receivables, and the fact that the moratorium is, we're collecting less. And then if you go to page 3A, if you look at, we have our total budget there compared to our actual year to date. And if you look at the operating revenues, it's right on target, almost 50%, as well as the operating expenses. So we are doing within a 1% change there. We're doing pretty much right in lines of what we said we were going to based on what our budget was predicting. Page four talks about our capital funds. So at the top you see our capital funds, where they're coming from, basically starting with the depreciation fund and our construction fund balance that we started with. And then you add your interest in your depreciation transfers by month. And we got some money for LED grant program. And then you can see your total use of capital funds, as I mentioned, about $2.8 million there. So we still have some money to fund the capital projects that we've asked for in our budget. And then good information, kilowatt hour sales, of course. I know Jane already went through some of this. So we're just under 0.5%. So I think we mentioned last year we were going to collect under 1% less, so we're almost right in lines with what we had said. And then, of course, we have our page of cash balances, which I think just shows a stable outlook where we are, considering how much payables we have and our monthly payroll. And then I believe we go into the detail of the sales by class, so you can see where the classes are either up or down. And it looks like right now the residential and commercial is pretty 5% increase in the residential, and the commercial is pretty stable right now. And then there's a slight increase on the street lighting and the municipal buildings. Our energy conservation funds, our energy conservation revenue, I'm sorry, is it's pretty even. It's right about net zero. And then we have our operating expenses, operating maintenance expenses. And if you skip 12 and go right to 12B, you can see that we're pretty much right in line, 49.74% of our budget at 6 months of the year. So we're still doing as predicted, which is great. And it's looking pretty stable.
Okay. Questions or comments for Wendy? If not, then...
No, looks good.
Is that a question, John?
Chairman, can I...
No.
Okay, go ahead.
Can I just make a quick comment?
Sure.
Wendy and her group have been working really, really hard to try to consolidate financials into, you know, just a few of them that capture all of it. Basically bringing it back to...
Balance sheet and P&L. We're trying to really get there, but I don't want to just, you know, I'm still trying to consolidate them. So I don't want to leave you with missing information until we get there.
Okay.
Well, there's a lot of different items, obviously.
Right.
Yeah. They change around, so you know, I always look for just major differences
right,
in any given large line item. The small ones are
right.
They always get washed out, but it seems like we're on track and total revenue is up 7%.
Yep.
If I read that correctly,
mm-hmm.
which is great, and that's good.
We're trying to change the financials back to standardization, also a limited amount of papers. I think what may have happened over the years is that something was submitted, and then someone said, it would be nice to see this, and then it would be nice to see this, and next thing you
right.
know, we got 8 pieces of paper. So we're trying to bring it back to, you know, standard utility financials.
Mm-hmm.
We'll also be adding the FERC numbers, because the other thing we're trying to do is consolidate efficiencies, which means whatever we're showing to you, that's what internal staff is going to be using as well. So it'll be one-stop shopping. We're all looking at the same numbers. We're
mm-hmm.
all looking at the same. So if there's anything on here that you're thinking you like or you don't like, I guess now would be, or, you know, pretty soon would be the time to let us know, and then we're just going to stick with, what are you thinking, 3 or 4 sheets?
I was hoping less than a half a dozen, yes, exactly. A little more, because we do like to see the capital funds and whatnot,
right.
but yes.
Yeah. If that's
right.
okay with the board.
Yeah, that sounds good.
That's fine. You know, the what I like to see is the projections of where you want to be at the end of the year, and then look at the trends in certain, obviously, in sales and
yep.
and cost and whatnot, and so that we become reactive to it before it occurs. As you recall, we got stuck a couple years ago with you know, not having to put in an increase in rates at the last minute because
right.
there was not attention paid in previous years to kind of where we were and where things were trending, and that's really that what I'm concerned about is being able to not get that same trap again.
And on that note, this is year 3, and so this is the cost of service study year.
Yep.
So every year we roll the model, and then every third year we committed to doing the cost of service. So Jane's group has been working on that, so we'll get even more of a breakdown of see how we're doing and our increases that we have had and that we're on target. So when we're rolling the cost of service into the budget
into
process.
The budget. Correct.
But Mayhew will come and do a presentation?
Correct.
Okay.
No, we can see Mayhew. Okay.
Good. Excellent.
Good. Excellent. Right, any other questions
okay.
or comments for Wendy?
Yeah. Thank you, Wendy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy.
If not, then Amid, you're next. Come on down.
Good evening.
Yep.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm glad to report the month of December's for engineering and operations activity. As you see, the first slide, it's showing the capital improvement projects. As Wendy mentioned, you know, we're right on the target as far as the capital expenditures and as operational expenditures concerns. We're 50-50. So we are right on the target where we should be. These are the listed projects that for the month of December, we spent $52,750, bringing the year to date to $368,534. The next slide is the routine construction, and those are the categories that, you know, they fit in this title. And for the month of December, we spent $126,809, bringing the year total to date is $903,151. This is only a section of the construction, big construction projects under the routine constructions, but the overall expenditures for the capital is approximately $2.8 million. So we are right on target.
Can I ask one quick question?
Sure.
When do you think the LED streetlight conversion will be complete? What's your estimation on that?
Okay, the estimation, it's going to be by FY 2018.
2018?
Yes. We are almost
by the end of next year.
By the end of next year, right. Every year we replace, you know, it was a three-year program for 2,450 lights being replaced, and right now we're almost close to 60% done.
Mm-hmm.
And by next year, it's got to be, all got to be done.
Right.
And it's going to cost approximately $800,000.
And there's a lot less electricity kilowatt
definitely.
Hours.
Oh, yeah. The savings are there, definitely.
Great.
Good. So the third slide is showing you the routine maintenance. I'm glad to report that, you know, well, we're making good progress on the maintenance and the capital improvement projects that, you know, they're both hand in hand, making the reliability to improve. And we're going in the right directions. And the transformer replacement program to the month of December, we did replace approximately 25% of the PADMON transformers, approximately 16% of the overhead transformers. The pole inspection programs, we 213 poles have been replaced to date, which 116 of those been transferred, and the transfer been completed. We're still making progress on those. The last time there was a question about the priority on the double poles and here, there, and the way we do that really, as we inspect these and the ones that the threat or the pose a threat to the safety, public safety, we get to those first, we replace them, and then we get to the rest in the order of the priority. And we inspect every single one of those that, you know, we have a double pole to and prioritize them based on, again, we evaluate the traffic and the safety and all of that consideration in order to make the list and do the transfer as we go on. So the quarterly inspection of the feeders, those are the listed feeders that, you know, they were inspected to see if there are any potential failures or any problems that we need to address. The manhole inspection program through the month of December, we inspected 961 out of the 1,237 manholes, and this is another good program that it's really paying back, so we can revisit and inspect the underground infrastructures and making improvements as we go. We found a few problems that we have captured before they become really catastrophic. So the porcelain cutout replacements is still 91% completed. We got 256 remaining that as we're going through the system and we're making improvements, we addressing those. The tree trimming for the month of December, we trimmed 87 spans. The year to date, it's bringing the total to 651 spans that trimmed. The substation maintenance, we infrared scanning. For the month of December, we didn't have any trouble, and neither we had problems in any of the major business parks that, you know, we infrared scanned.
Sure. Go ahead.
Sean, I just make a comment. I noticed in the paper the other day that one of the major investor-owned utilities, I forget which one, has just decided to put in a very major tree trimming program,
right,
because they've determined that tree limbs during storms cause outages, which is, I'd like to commend RMLD for being well ahead of that curve.
Thank you. Yeah. But this is our biggest challenge during the storm. You know, we got two major problems, animals.
Right.
And no matter how much, you know, you have animal guards and here, there, they find their way, you know, into the energized parts of the equipment, and they cause damages, especially to all their equipment. And the trees, huge, the pine trees, that shallow roots, and, you know, they make extensive damages. The last storm, actually, that's what we experienced. And that's why, you know, it's taking time. Yes, sir.
George, go ahead.
I just wanted to ask you, how's the Wildwood substation holding up?
Oh, the Wildwood substation. Well, as you know, the switchgear is old. The transformers
are
old.
Why it's on my
and
concern.
We've been making some repairs to the switchgear. We did it in three phases. The phase one, we had asbestos. We had to remove the asbestos from the joints. It's all done. The section of the bus from the transformer to the bus, the connection, that's been re-insulated. That was tracking. And now next week, the first week in March, I'm sorry, we are re-insulating the entire bus on both sides. And once we're done, breakers are fairly new within the last 10 years or so. So it should hold for another 5 to 10 years, you know, now that we're keeping up with the maintenance. You know, that substation hasn't been maintained for so long. Mm. And the transformers are old. Nothing that old means bad, but, you know, it's pretty much at the end of its useful life. So we're making all the repairs and keeping up with the maintenance to keep that going until we find the substation, suitable land, that, you know, we can build the new substations, which that is work in progress. And we have identified, we have located two potential land for building the new substations in Ballotvale area, and we're working on those.
So this will handle it until
yes,
you guys...
it's gonna keeping my fingers crossed, you know. it will be able to.
Thank you.
Again, we had the major problems with the substation maintenance. Station 4 is all set. All the breakers are new. The relays are new. We've made huge improvement to Station 4. Station 3 is the next that we're going to be done basically by for the maintenance part of it, and also upgrading the equipment. We should be done by June 15th. And then the next is the new substation, that if we secure the land, we should start building. And in 3 years, I can with confidence tell you that we are in very solid shape. But you got a way to go.
Yeah.
Okay, the next slide is the double poles. As you see, the ownership, we got approximately 16,000 poles throughout our service territory. 50% is the ownership, RMLD, 50% Verizon. However, the custodial in Reading is split between us and Verizon. North Reading is us, and Linfield and Wilmington is with Verizon. The next one is my favorite program, Engines, which tells me how many transfers are done and how many double poles we have, and here, there, which is very good. In Linfield, we got 14. In North Reading, we got 104, which 13 transfers we got to do, and 91 poles that we're going to have to pull. But these are the ones that they mostly double pole. The problem is, you know, we're waiting for the third party to get off, because we've done our transfers, and then, you know, we have to wait for Verizon, Comcast to do their transfer before we can pull the pole butts out in North Reading. The same thing in Reading, we got about 50, the transfers are 23, and we got 27 pole butts that we need to remove. In Wilmington, we got 65, which we got 59 transfers to do, and one attachment, the four pole butts that need to be removed. And again, this shows really actually the activity that we are doing continuously. We're keeping up with the maintenance and upgrading the system that hasn't been maintained for almost 15 years. So we are catching up with those maintenances, which shows then. And again, I want to thank our valued customers for being patient with us and tolerating our, you know, those ugly double poles. We're getting to them, you know, in a timely manner. And so we're making progress on those. The next slide is showing the health of the system, basically, the system reliability, SAIDI, KD, and SAIFI. For the category, the SAIDI, we are well under the regional average and the national average, SAIDI and SAIFI, because of the number of huge outages that we had, that the damages they made by the trees in the storm, they're slightly above the regional, and we're well under the national average. So overall, the reliability is good, and as we're making progress with the maintenance and keeping up with the maintenance, the system is getting better and better. The last slide shows you the outage causes for the 5 years average as well as the 2016, and you can see that the equipment in the equipment category were shrinking. So that means our maintenance program is paying off, and we started seeing a slight improvements on those. In the categories of trees, we still, unless if we remove all the pine trees, from the roads and here they clear them, that's not, but we at least we keeping up, we are being steady for the past, compared to after this 5 years, past 5 years. The wildlife is still a challenge, but as we're upgrading to the new equipment, we have more protection, so hopefully that's going to be shrinking down too. So that concludes my report. If you have any questions, by all means.
Questions or comments from anybody?
Yeah. I just wanted to add that Hamid and I met with all of the fire chiefs from each of the towns a week ago, and we had a nice presentation for them. It was aerial views of each of the substations, the type of equipment that is in there, the type of fire hazards that are in there, the precautions that they need to take. We went through each item. We also went over all of our solar areas, buildings that have solar. And we've already installed, but we'll make sure that any solar development will have, you know, this particular property is being fed by two different sources. So this will be another added safety feature to any fire responding. And so I think the meeting went really well, and it was attended by all four towns, so.
Great. Okay, anything else for Hamid?
Any questions?
You've got a bid?
We got one bid.
One bid, so why don't you give us a setup?
You want me to read it?
Go ahead, give us a setup, and we'll go
okay.
from there.
Okay, this bid is for the grant bid IFB 2017-34 Grants and Landscape Services. We had, this is Chapter 30B bid. We had 29 bidders that they showed up. We only got five bids, received five bids from five of those companies. And the lowest responsive bidder, based on the Chapter 30B requirements, was Greenscape Land Design Incorporation for a total of $110,952. And the analysis that this is a three-year contract. The last time that we went out to bid, it was approximately $160,000. This time, we're getting more services for less money, for approximately $110,000. So there's a saving of $50,000 with this new bid, which is great. They're doing a great job. We're very happy with them.
Okay.
So. I guess we're gonna have to vote. The board is gonna have to vote on that.
Yep. So, John, you want
to
give
like
the motion?
Give
yep.
the motion?
Yep. Read the motion, please.
Move that proposal 2017-34 for grounds and landscape services be awarded to Greenscape Land Design Inc. for $110,952, pursuant to Chapter 30B, on the recommendation of the general manager.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Discussion?
Just a quick question. You said there's five bidders?
There were five bidders, right. And
five.
The analysis are included over here. The three top bidders, that they were all responsive bidders. No, the three of them, they didn't take exceptions. Two, they took some exceptions.
So you had three real proposals?
Yes, three real proposals. The lowest, $110,000, $952. The second lowest was the Grand Masters Landscape for $166,579.89. And the highest was $195,583 from Earthworks. Earthworks was the one that, you know, we had contract with the last time. And it was $160,000, and now they were higher, actually, $35,000 more they were asking for the next 3 years contract. Mm-hmm. And
thank you.
And we've done our due diligence on the contractor?
Yes.
Okay.
Everything is there. Check the background and everything. They did a great job during the last storm, and, you know, that we had for providing the support that we needed, and
okay.
We're very happy with them.
That's considerably less money.
Oh, it's much, you know, yeah. And more services we're getting.
Good job.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor, please raise your right hand. The motion carries. Let the record show it was 4-0. And we're just on to general discussion. So our next meeting is scheduled, according to what I have here, March 23rd. I think we talked about moving that.
30th, right.
The 23rd?
You're changing it to the 23rd?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, are we okay with the 23rd with the members?
Yeah, that's better for me, actually. I can't do the 30th.
We skipped over the general discussion?
We're still on.
Okay.
Let's get the meeting dates
got
first.
Got it.
Get the meeting dates first. Then we'll have general discussion. And the meeting after that is tentatively scheduled for April the 20th. Our next meeting after that. The CAB is meeting March the 1st, George?
Yes.
So we do need a representative to go to that meeting. I definitely am not available. I can tell you that right now.
Which meeting is that? Wednesday, the March
The CAB.
1st?
That's Wednesday, March 1st.
Let's see.
I don't know if anybody's available to go.
First. I'm not going to be here. I'm going to be in New York City.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll go to that.
You'll go to that?
Yep.
Okay.
March 1st.
All right. So
meet the new
Hennessy
cab members.
Go to that. Mm. Okay. So. You had something for Jim?
Yeah, I had a couple quick questions, sure. Maybe go for ahead. Colleen or for Jane.
Yep.
I think a few meetings ago, I raised the idea of when we next do our rates, is there any chance of having a time-based incentive built into maybe an industrial commercial rate where they get a break much of the time, but they pay a little more on the times when we need them to? Is that something we're actively studying, or is that?
We can talk to the consultant on that. He's looking, okay. Right now, we've had a couple meetings with him, and they've just looked at modeling fiscal year 16 to make sure that the model is accurate. And then we're going to take once we get the budget information to him, he has to incorporate that to see what the rates would be. So we can discuss with him time-based incentives for commercial customers.
Okay. And the other thing I wanted to, in writing a report on the Concord Municipal Light Plan, it just came up in passing that they did an RFP for solar and found that maybe it's cheaper to actually self-build. And I don't have any more information than that, but I wondered if it's possible for us to do an analysis for any place where we have a flat roof that we might have access to, whether it's public or private. Would it be within the realm of possibility for us to simply procure the panels and they get sit on the roof with a weight? I've seen it done. There's no roof penetration. It's not that complicated. They can be lifted off if anything needs to get changed out, and just what the numbers would be. You know, so we did a great job on the gas generator. Is it possible to do this now that solar keeps dropping in price, where we have flat roofs and easy installation if we have free access to the roof? Like, how hard would it be to just kind of do a back of the envelope in the next month or two?
We can get that.
We can look at it.
Okay.
Again, we won't do the integrity of the roof.
Yeah, right. Just assume you have access to a flat surface,
yep.
And you just place the stuff there. We procure it, put it out. We own it. We run it just like we own and run the gas generator. How do those numbers look? Forget about the, you know, I know we don't get the tax incentives. But we're also cutting out all the middleman and all that stuff. You know, it may be that it works. That's what Chris Roy at Concord told me. He thinks that it would, but I shouldn't quote him. But Chris, if you're watching, because it's not like I have numbers to point to, but it's just a conversation I had that made me curious.
We'll get that.
Okay.
Can I just ask, are they hiring a structural engineer to look at the integrity of the roof?
This is, I've given you the limit of my limited knowledge. And I don't know, you know. I assume there's some minimal due diligence. These things are not that heavy.
We have one in the lobby. Did you see it?
I did not.
Oh, go to the lobby. Yeah. It's very interesting.
I mean, relative to stuff people put on roofs, compressors and AC handlers and all that, I mean, it's just a, you know, it's just a flat piece of silicon.
They are somewhat aerodynamic.
Sure. I mean, and they I've seen it done where they're just literally held down with 4-inch thick, 8-by-whatever concrete, you know, those half concrete blocks.
Yeah.
They're just a couple of those hold down each thing on a plastic frame. You know, it's not like sticking a giant. Anyway, so there's that. And one last small thing.
Can I call Chris Roy and
sure.
ask him about this?
Yeah,
I
mean.
Already done the no sense in reinventing the wheel.
Yeah, and I shouldn't drag the poor guy into it. It's just a conversation I had. And sure, call him. But I just wonder, you know, we can get prices on stuff, and you know the numbers backwards and forwards, Jane, as far as what makes sense for...
Well, I think I mentioned it to you. We are supposed to go, Jane and I are supposed to go to Concord and meet with him to talk
okay.
about a number of topics.
Oh, great.
So,
and there may be others, too. It's just...
crazy the last couple of weeks,
sure.
But hopefully next week or something we can make an appointment with him.
Okay. And the last thing I want to ask about is I got an email from the Reading High School Drama Club, which is looking to replace their incandescent floodlights with LEDs. And they were wondering if there's any RMLD program to help with that. I know we have a program, but I know it's more for like a commercial, like a customer, right, as opposed to a group.
Yeah, well, the high school would be a customer.
Right.
So we do have an LED lighting rebate program.
Right.
So if you want to give me a contact name, I'll
okay.
have
okay. It's actually not, it's not the high school per se, because it's, the high school's not paying for the equipment. It's a club, it's the club or the parents club, the parents group and the student club that runs it, and they use donations to buy this equipment. So it's because the school doesn't have the funds to do everything. So that's what this is, and so it's a little different than usual. So
I'm sure there must be a way to work that out. Maybe they donate the money to the school, and the school could buy it.
Maybe that, yeah. That, but they're very high-consuming floodlights that they use now, and the LEDs, I don't know.
You can be named,
okay.
Dave, but we'll
okay.
have to reach out to
you. Great. That's all. Thank you.
Yeah, the only thing I want to mention is I'm noticing that in a lot of parking garages downtown, there's more charging stations.
Yep.
I've seen quite a few now that are downtown in parking garages, and I would... I live next to the railroad station. I mean, I keep thinking, geez, this wouldn't it be a great place for a charging station?
Well, Janus Group is working diligently on that. We're part of the Volkswagen
grant program.
Right.
And we're just waiting for the snow to melt in order to, Paul McGonigal is redoing the parking lot out there so that you'll be pulling in, the way you pull in will be a little bit different than the way it's laid out right now.
Mm-hmm.
I gave them a bunch of pictures from Braintree Light, and there, there's a, it's the quick charge. We're going to put two of them in, a quick charge and then the not so quick charge for older vehicles,
right.
So that you'd have those two options. And then we're looking at other areas around town that you can pull off the highway. And we're also looking at home installed, charging stations, which is another program that Braintree's doing that's working very well.
The interesting thing I saw with the parking garage is they're actually, this is a revenue source for the parking garage, is what they, how they're doing this. Mm-hmm. They're actually charging people as a revenue source for them. So I think, you know, I don't know why the T doesn't think about the things like this, and yeah.
Or shopping centers will do it, and it's a way to get, they'll give the electricity for free, but it's a service for their customers, like Whole Foods does that. So either way, the electricity is, if it's in our district, we're the ones providing it.
But anyway, I just want to mention that. What I'm seeing more and more of this around. So, okay, and we have anything else in the general discussion? If not, I'll entertain a motion to go into executive session.
So moved.
Okay, let me read what the motion is. Move that the board go into executive session to consider the purchase of real estate and to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
Is that seconded?
I second that motion.
Mr. Stempak made the motion. Mr. Talbot seconded. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Mr. Talbot?
Mr. Talbot.
Mr. Stempak?
Mr. Stempak.
Mr. Hennessy?
Hennessy, aye.
Okay. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very good.
Good seeing you, George.
Same here. I'll see you.
You'll see you Wednesday. What time do you guys start?
6:30,
a little earlier.
We go early so we can get done early.
Yeah,
of course.
That's good.
Well, you got to travel. This is traveling to from different towns. Yeah. I got to get back.
I would come. I'm going to be in New York, unfortunately. So.
Yeah. Well, it's good seeing you guys.
You too.
You know.
Haven't seen in a while.
See you soon.
Back
out. See, John, you didn't get the solid blue shirt memo.
I did not. Look at the
crazy stripes. It's supposed to be solid blue shirt night.
Crazy.
At
the crazy stripes.
We all got solid blue
crazy
shirts.
Crazy stripes.
I got the memo.
So next time, I'll wear solid blue. You all wear stripes.
I did have a choice of stripes this morning.
I think if I go to Washington, you got some.
It was more discussions about, you know, if you're.